Okay, so I guess first we need to check sound, and this is the informal part, right? This doesn't count. Well, here we are. Thank you all for being here. This is amazing. It's sad that we're here just to protect ourselves from what we realize is a very dangerous threat to Southern California and possibly the world with what we've seen from Fukushima. We're here today to speak about the problem with the generators. Since the end of January, we've seen that the electrical power seems to get by okay in Southern California without nuclear power. It's amazing that we've had this risk all these years and find that we don't even need the nuclear power. Now we find that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is anxious to resolve this problem. We're glad to have Chairman Jaczko here today and a lot of attention on this very important matter. But we're also concerned about the history of the NRC and Edison and the lack of trust that we have over the history of this whole experience with San Onofre right in our backyard. Several reasons of our distrust have accumulated to the point where we just have to demand as citizens that our safety is primary concern over profit. And unfortunately, that has not been the case so far. If we were to let things go as they've gone in the past, it's very likely we would experience a Fukushima right here in Southern California. And that's why we're here today, as citizens protecting ourselves from that eventual catastrophe. It's just a matter of time, and that's why it's so urgent that we understand we don't accept flimsy answers or shallow responses. We're here to find out answers from the NRC, and we want to know exactly what the root cause is, why those tubes have failed. These are brand new generators, and they shouldn't have failed, and because of that problem, not only have we lost $7 million of ratepayer money, but we're probably going to be asked to spend that money all over again for technology that we don't even know is certain to not have a similar problem. And the fact is that when those tubes fail, they can leak, but they can burst. And if they burst, there will be a chain reaction. Those tubes will disintegrate in the generator, causing not only steam releasing radiation, but it's the supply to the reactor core. And if that water supply to the reactor core is gone, then we have a meltdown. And instead of Fukushima, where the offshore wind took most of the radiation over the ocean, we have 8 million people that will be exposed to this horrible nightmare, living with radiation, not knowing where it is, can't see it, can't taste it, can't feel it. We're just going to be living with this nightmare and probably never be able to move back to the land that we love, and this freeway that connects San Diego to LA will be lost forever. It's a nightmare we don't need, and as I said, we can do without this energy source, and we're going to get by through the summer all right. So we have other people that would like to speak, and I'm very glad to introduce the next speaker.
Can you give your name, please, first, and spell your first and last name?
Yes, my name is Gary Hedrick. I'm founder of San Clemente Green. My name is spelled GaryHeadrick. Thank you.
Thank you. Everybody do the same, please.
Yeah. Yeah, next up, I'd like to ask Gene Stone to speak.
Hi, my name is Gene Stone from Residents Organized for a Safe Environment. I'm glad to be here today. Thank you for all coming. I want to point to my monitor and this monitor and let you know that radiation levels here are a little higher than they should be. So the rocks over there registered 102 counts per minute. It's different. Rocks are different than the air and the ground. The air is always moving, and the ground, the dust gets blown away. The rock has been there for a long time. It's reading way higher. Anything over 40 is too high. We have a problem here. We need to continue to initiate our volunteer monitoring system so that the citizens will know what's happening out here and in our community. What I'd like to say is that We're glad that Chairman Jaczko is here, and Senator Feinstein, and Congressman Issa. And we call upon them to make sure that there's a comprehensive investigation of the significant design changes to the steam generators made by Edison. We also want to know if there were any laws broken when they made these changes. They were supposed to make changes like on like, meaning they were supposed to repair and replace with the same type of things. They did not do that. That's out in the news already. So we deserve to know what's going on and how those changes will affect the plant. And we demand that the NRC not allow this plant to open until there's been some testing done to make sure that those tubes will be safe if they're turned on. The part of the story you may not know is how close we were to a meltdown when this steam leak happened. If they restart and these tubes fail again and the systems in place fail, then we'll have an accident. And our guests from Japan that were here at 311, they reminded us that they believed their company, TEPCO, they believed their government, that everything was safe. They now, in their words, know that that was a lie and that they were not safe, and they are not safe. And one of the gentlemen that we brought from Japan just talked to me yesterday through my iPhone, and he said his neighbor's dying of heart disease caused by cesium. Thank you very much.
I guess I'm next. My name's Ray Lutz, L-U-T-Z. I'm with citizensoversight.org from San Diego area. My background is in engineering, so I like to read over all of this stuff that they produced. And it is kind of ghastly how the engineers at Southern California Edison went out of their way to avoid public scrutiny of this massive change to the plant, like on like. But what they did was extract probably a whole third of the critical area of this plant, took it out and replaced it with brand new ones that had been completely redesigned on the inside. Yeah, the outside shell looked the same, but the inside was completely redesigned, and you can read about that in the international, it's called Nuclear Energy International, a journal article that the engineers themselves wrote about how proud they were that they worked around public scrutiny and were able to avoid review by the NRC for this massive change. And guess what's happening now? We have this thing in distraught because of their decisions to misdesign it. We have some important decisions to make as members of the public. And the problem here is that our elected officials have all taken money from Southern California Edison and Southern SDG&E and Sempra Energy, massive amounts of money. The media takes money from these organizations as well, advertise on all of your stations. So it's hard to get the message out here sometimes about what's going on. You also have public relations officials from the plant who go overboard on telling you, painting a pretty picture about what's going on here. It isn't a pretty picture, folks. It isn't a pretty picture in Fukushima. It isn't a pretty picture in Chernobyl. It isn't a pretty picture in Three Mile Island. We don't want it even uglier here. We put a great trust in these organizations to provide energy safely. We don't want anything that's unsafe. They have to be absolutely safe. Not just a release now and then, oh, that's no problem. That wasn't a release that was of a concern because it just drifted away into the air. They're supposed to be absolutely safe. What we found out with Three Mile Island, there was no earthquake there or tsunami. That was human error and a stuck valve. And the whole place went into meltdown. It wasn't an earthquake or tsunami in Chernobyl. That was another error. And now that place is encased in concrete and you still can't go within 50 miles of it. But we now know that it isn't just human error and these mistakes that'll turn this into a disaster. We also know that we live on an earthquake moving tectonic plate right here. This is called the Ring of Fire all around the Pacific. The same ring of fire that's over in Japan comes all the way around here. We're on the same ring. The movements that happen over there move over here because this is the edge of the same plate. We know that we're due for another huge earthquake here. California is supposed to fall into the ocean, some people say. Now, we don't believe that. But we do know that we're at least 16 feet behind where this thing's supposed to be. So the plates are supposed to move 16 feet any day. They can happen. We also have the ocean right here, and guess what? We can have big waves. It was 133 feet in Japan. We only have a 14-foot seawall over high tide here. That's a little bit different than 133 feet. Now you say, well, we have backup systems. They'll just click right on, and that'll protect us. Guess what? This plant has pumps hooked up to batteries. They were disconnected for not a day, not 4 days. Not even a week, not 4 weeks, not 4 months, 4 solid years. They were not hooked up. That means if we had any disaster, guess what would happen? No pumps turn on, thing melts down, thing is devastated, 8 million people have to be evacuated. We can't trust these guys. They can't even keep the batteries hooked up. Now we also have the earthquake. They say, well, we're protected for 7.0 earthquake. It was 9.0 in Japan. That's 100 times more. It's only 2 digits, but it's 10 times for every digit. That's 100 times worse earthquake than we're used to here. But guess what? They've only been measuring earthquakes for a short time. We don't know what happens over millions of years. We could have a huge earthquake here. Lake Wolford over by Escondido. It's being taken down and rebuilt. Why? Because it only is designed for a 7.0 earthquake. This is only a 7.0 here, but they're not talking about taking it down and rebuilding it. I hope they don't, because it should just be taken down and not rebuilt. Steam generators, they said, well, we'll just redesign everything on the inside and we'll fool the public. Yeah, we'll have that skin on the outside. No one will know that we've changed everything. NRC, we paid you off, so you're not going to ask us any questions. Now we find out they've changed the whole guts of the thing and they don't even operate. The last one's operated how long? 28 years. This one dies in 18 months. Blows a cork on the inside, blows out and releases radioactive gases to the atmosphere. Well, that's no problem, they say. No one died from that. How many people died? They keep saying that, oh, there's been no deaths. There's been up to 1 million people died from premature cancer near Chernobyl. Who talks about this? Not the media. They've been paid off by the nuclear companies. Now look, we've got a situation here where these are shut down due to engineering problems. We also know that this is a disaster area waiting to happen, even if those didn't happen. This company cannot be trusted to run this safely. It cannot be turned back on. We cannot trust these people. The public is the only group that can say no. Will the elected officials say no? Doubt it. They've been paid off. How about the media? Well, they never say no to anything. They're just media. They cover stuff. So they don't say no. Hopefully they will cover it. Who does say no? Only the public, and that's why we're here. And we're here to say no. You are not going to turn the plant back on. It's going to be decommissioned. And if you attempt to restart it, you will be endangering the public because we will have protests. We will have people that are going crazy around this plant to make sure it stops. We are not going to stop doing this. So cut our losses now and decommission the plant. Do not restart this plant. Thank you very much. Yes. Yay.
Okay. Either way, whatever you guys work out. Thanks, Don.
Hi. We've got to make sure God is heard by all of you.
Yeah, we got to get it all.
Yeah, right.
Go ahead, Smarty.
Okay. Hi, my name is Donna Gilmore. I'm a citizen who lives in San Clemente. I got involved in this a couple of years ago before Fukushima when I read an article in the paper that said employees were being punished by Edison for reporting safety problems. I thought that has to be a crock. Nobody in their right mind would run a nuclear plant and punish employees for safety concerns. Guess what? I was wrong. San Onofre has the worst safety record of all nuclear plants in the entire country. Employees who, about 10 times worse, and employees who report these violations, they get punished, they get fired. So I reached out to whistleblowers to find out if they were legitimate. I found out they were. And I created a website called sanonofresafety.org that our groups down here are using to share information. It's fact, it's all based on government data, scientific data. It's not, you know, a crazy say anything kind of thing. So I highly recommend that you visit that. And then the biggest thing I think I found out is we don't even need either nuclear plant. We don't need San Onofre, we don't need Diablo Canyon. We have excess energy in California, excess power in California. You're seeing right now, we have plenty of energy and San Onofre's down. And then Edison started putting out PR saying, oh, well, we need it in the summer. We don't need it in the winter. Okay, well, let's keep it down in the winter then. We agree on that. But we don't need it in the summer. The California ISO that manages the grid, that for years they've had transmission plans that say we don't need San Onofre for safety. It's right in their transmission plans. I've got the links on the website. And now at the April presentation they made, they have a list of contingencies to cover so we won't have a blackout, rolling blackouts during a peak season. So why are we living with these risks, these crazy risks, for energy that we can live without? It's like the emperor has no clothes, but he's got a lot of money, our money, you know. These reports that are out about where they're trying to scare us about blackouts, if you go look at the documents, you look at the facts, you will see the facts say otherwise from the industry itself, from the electricity grid itself. So I'm hoping that the media reports this story because I think it's an extremely important story, and we only seem to have had one side in the paper. And in my research, I've discovered that we haven't been able to count on the NRC or Edison or the state of California, our elected officials, to make us safe. The only thing that's going to help is with the people get educated and stand up and vote. So I've gotten involved in the California Nuclear Initiative, and this is where the people can download a petition from the sanonofresafety.org website, sign it, send it in, and the deadline is this weekend to get the petitions in. And we would love to have some media attention so the people finally have a say in their future and a say in protecting their families. What we have right now is not a risk of nuclear blackouts. What we have is nuclear blackmail.
Blackouts or blackmail, yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your time. Thank you for coming.
Hi, Patty Davis, PATTIDAVIS. Thank you all for coming today.
Patty, identify yourself, please. Who are you with?
Hi, I'm a member of San Clemente Green, San Onofre Safety, and I'm a supporter of Rose and the other groups that are all working so very hard on this.
And the initiative.
Okay, the lessons of Fukushima are being ignored by Edison. They're putting millions of people's lives at risk right here in California, in Southern California. The NRC needs to stop. They need to listen. They need to understand and they need to act. Fukushima has caused an enormous amount of suffering for hundreds of thousands of people in Japan. We cannot ignore that. It's still happening. As a community, we have severe trust problems with Edison. We cannot trust SC Edison. And the NRC has a very poor record of enforcing the strict safety standards that a nuclear power plant would have to live by. We saw what happened in Japan, and we're terrified. We're terrified that it could happen right here in Southern California. We want to prevent San Onofre from being our Fukushima.
Yeah. Woo! Woo!
Thank you, everyone. Just remember, we cannot trust SC Edison. They're gambling with our lives, our children's lives, our property values. It's not worth it. Thank you.
Okay, just one more thing from me, Ray Lutz again. We are going to be having another rally so the public can come and make their voices heard about this on April 29th. It's going to be south of the plant in our same rally site where we had about 400 people on the anniversary of Fukushima. This rally is going to be commemorating again the continued meltdown at Fukushima, where we had 10 nuclear cores and complete meltdown. It's about 10 times worth it than Chernobyl. Nobody talks about it in the media much, but it is happening. It's still happening. It's completely out of control. It's 10 times the fatal dose, and even robots cannot go in. In addition to continuing to commemorate that, we're commemorating the Three Mile Island disaster, which occurred on April 26th. And it is the Chernobyl on April 26th. It is the 26-year anniversary. And just recently on, what was it, March 27th?
March 27th, 1979.
Yeah, we had the Three Mile Island disaster. So this is a disaster season for nuclear reactors for some reason, this time of the year. And so we don't want another disaster happening. So that's what the rally is gonna be about. We asked all of the media to help promulgate this for the public to come, because we don't have massive amounts of money like Southern California Edison has to promulgate their message. They spend ratepayer money to tell everybody their point of view. And we don't have ratepayer money for our point of view. We have to do it on zero money. So we asked the public to come. We're asking the media to help us because we don't pay for your advertising. But yet we're asking you to help the enemy in this case, which is the people, because we're not paying your ad. So please help us. We're trying to get the public down there to have their voices heard. And this is the only group that can actually stand up and say, no, it's not going to happen here. So thank you for letting me announce that.
Buses will be running from San Diego.
Thank you. We're wrapping it up, but we'll be taking questions. And I want to remind everyone that we're pleased that the NRC has invited us to participate in a meeting later on today at the Doubletree Inn in Dana Point. We're going to insist that they do the proper testing, and not just testing, but we need to verify that the tests are right. We want independent verification that we know the root cause of why those generator tubes failed. So we're going to get to the bottom of that, and we're going to insist on being participants in this process, and we will not allow this plant to start if it's at all unsafe. So thank you, and we'll take questions or anything else.
Yeah, I hear a lot of distrust of the NRC as well as Edison, but particularly on the NRC side, considering that the federal government basically stopped the expansion of the nuclear industry for 30 years, why do you still have such distrust of the NRC?
Well, as founder of San Clemente Green, I was approached by whistleblowers in 2009. And coincidentally, the first whistleblower was explaining to me how there were risky procedures going on at the plant because they were behind schedule. They were skipping hot functional testing, which is something that this nuclear engineer operator felt was required. But because of behind schedule and over budget, they pushed right through without doing this time-consuming test that should have been done. and look at the results. You know, I took all this information to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and they ignored it. They said, you know, 6 months later, they report back that, you know, that's really not required to do that testing. That's only for brand new plants. Well, we saw where that got us.
I'd like to answer that question. I'd like to answer that question as well.
Here, come on up to the microphone.
One of the reasons we don't trust the NRC is because they went 3 months after the disaster in Japan, they went over and made the near-term report of Fukushima. Four of the five NRC commissioners, except for Chairman Jaczko, wanted to not do anything. In that report, which I've read from cover to cover, there is not one regulation. There is only suggestions. They make suggestions to California Edison instead of making them in regulation form. And then, so they don't have to follow these suggestions. It's a suggestion. Now, if they're going to learn lessons from Fukushima, then they need to make that a regulation so that they are forced to do that. You look at the history of the NRC, they've made very few regulations. That's why we don't trust them.
But address my central question, though. If you see them as kind of mindless advocates for nuclear energy, why have they presided over the zero expansion of the industry?
Well, that's
years?
It. Let's question the authority of the NRC. The Atomic Energy Commission took authority in 1952 of everything nuclear.
Don't go back that far. Just go back to the NRC and TMI and why the NRC.
Well, this is where it's at. The states have a right to decide. This is not 1952 anymore. We know about disasters. No one knew at that time. They gave away their power to the Atomic Energy Commission, which was an advocate for the Atomic Energy.
That's correct, but that's why the NRC was created.
Right, and they have failed repeatedly over and over to do that. It is time for the senators, our California senators, to support Senator Sanders and Mr. Markey and have this be a state's rights. We need to be able to vote whether we want it or not.
Well, I would like to address your question.
Thank you.
The reason we didn't have nuclear plants for so long is we had a meltdown. We had Chernobyl. We had Three Mile Island. And so it kind of, you know, the PR wasn't good, you know. But now they're starting up again. And actually, Jaczko was the only one that voted to not approve new nuclear plants until the lessons of Fukushima were implemented. And he was overruled by the four other commissioners. So that makes at least four commissioners that we can't trust, that they're putting the profits over the safety of the public when they know that there are serious problems and we could be a Fukushima. So that's and our representative ISA in this district is supporting those four commissioners, and people need to know that. ISA is supporting the four commissioners that wanted to have new plants built before the lessons for Fukushima were incorporated so that we didn't have a meltdown. So we all know who ISA is representing here. And also, if you want to know more about the inadequacies of the NRC, the SanOnofreSafety.org website has a link to AP Wire investigations. It has links to the federal investigative body in the government that can give you a whole slew of reasons. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission has lower standards for existing nuclear plants than it does for new plants. You could not build San Onofre today with current regulations to build a new plant, but yet it continues to stay open. And the U.S. Geological Society says the probability of Southern California having a large earthquake, like an 8.0 earthquake, is about 66%, and that is also on the website. So if you as a media person have that question, I highly recommend that you, I've tried to make it easy as possible so you could go and get the facts. There's a section on NRC problems where repeatedly you can see the judgment that was made by somebody at the NRC to let unsafe plants continue to run, and we're a good example. This is years of NRC being aware of problems. There were reports of problems with the steam generators when they were installed. Employees are getting terminated and harassed at San Onofre for reporting problems. And the NRC, they said, we can't do anything. Right down there it says, oh, well, we don't have a regulation for that.
Tell us about that chart, what it means, and first of all, who compiled it?
Oh, okay. This chart, a whistleblower showed me how to read the NRC website. These are NRC statistics.
Here's the bigger one, Donna.
Okay. All right. This chart goes over multiple years. The red line, which on the far right, represents a San Onofre's the number of complaints. They call them safety allegations against Edison. The blue lines are all the other 64 plants in the entire country, their rate of complaints from employees. As you can see, San Onofre is off the chart. Yeah, there are 64 plants, multiple reactors. And this has been going on for years, and their rate has been going up. There's also another chart that looks very similar to this, the rate of harassments against employees, discrimination against employees that have reported safety violations. There'll be that's also on the website. You can get copies of these charts. They have an off the chart rate of retaliation.
So I make sure I understand. So these are safety violations raised by employees to the NRC.
Employees and on-site contractors.
And so what was the number for San Onofre and over what period of time?
The chart goes from 2007 to 2011. And San Onofre had 144 allegations, and the average in that, well, Diablo Canyon is pretty high too, 50, but you know, it's still high. But if you average it out, the average for most plants is about, about 10 a year. Well, we're 10 times worse than the average of all plants in the entire country. And this is safety violations, safety. Yeah, well, 90% of the NRC funding comes from the nuclear industry, so that's another factor. But did I answer your question about the chart? This is 100% NRC data. I took the table. I did that myself. I took the table that they have on their website, and the link to the website is on the chart, and I just put it into a chart form in an Excel spreadsheet. But it's all their data. It's not my data.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'd just like to add one more thing about the NRC. It's a revolving door, like many of these other regulatory agencies.
Yeah.
You have people coming from the industry in and out. And recently, because of the push to keep all these really old plants operating, they've been modifying the regulations to allow them to operate, saying, well, gee, that threshold, that was just made up. Now, remember, this is a fairly new industry, folks. It's only been around for 30, 40 years. That's nothing compared to the 30,000 years of waste that we could have on hand. We've never really decommissioned very many plants. We don't have the experience yet of what does the public need to do to shut down a plant. This is maybe the first plant where we're going to have to take control and say, you know, enough is enough, this has to shut down. Eventually, this plant will shut down. Eventually, the time will come. And no matter when it happens, the industry people will say, oh, we just spent $670 million. We don't want to shut it down now. They're always going to be in that position. It's just like an old junker car. It's hard to say, should I put in the next fix or should I keep it running? One thing to look at for NRC, the gentleman that asked the question about does the NRC, why are they a non-functional? They haven't fined any of these plants for years. They say stuff, but they're teethless. They don't have any real power to put pressure on Southern California Edison. There's no fines. Go back and look. This is just the tip of the iceberg. The fact that there's complaints, nothing happens to the complaints. Because the employees say, you could lose your job. This could be shut down, and then you'll be out of work. Scare you. And then the Nuclear Regulatory Commission doesn't fine them for anything. So nothing happens. The only place it comes to an end is with the public, and the reason we haven't had the plants open is the public said no, we're not putting plants in. That's the reason. The industry would love to have them. The NRC would go along. That's why they're in business. They would grow bigger and stronger if they had a lot of plants. They'd love it. So it's only the public that says no.
Right.
Frank, is your beef with the NRC or is it with the plant?
Both.
Well, both, but there, you know, the plant, we, look, this is what our topic is. If we shut down the NRC today, that would do nothing, wouldn't it? We have to shut this plant down and make sure that these steam generators that were misdesigned by Southern California Edison are not continued to be used.
Here.
We could continue to have an NRC forever, as far as I'm concerned. I have no beef against them. Let them be dysfunctional, like the rest of government.
The beef with them is that we want them to do their job. When 90% of their funding
Hold on. I understand. My question is, from the signs and from what you just said, it seems like it doesn't matter what the NRC does or what this plant does for safety, you want to shut it down.
That's my position.
That's my position.
My position, and the public says, and I'm trying to represent people in my organization, and I don't necessarily represent everybody. My position is, this is a dangerous place. Earthquakes, tidal waves, it shouldn't have been built there to begin with. Number two, they're out of control. They safety violations are crazy. Batteries left off for 4 years. Guess what? NRC, where were they? During 4 years of time when the backup batteries were left off from 2004 to 2008, we had no protection. What was the NRC? That's a good question. Go up to the NRC and ask them. Folks, what were you doing between 2004 and 2008? Didn't you have any inspections of the backup generators? Why not? Paid off? I don't know. Because it doesn't make any sense to anybody that the backup batteries would not be hooked up for 4 years. No sense. It doesn't make sense for these new steam generators to be misdesigned by their top engineer saying these are going to last forever. They break in 18 months. Doesn't make any sense.
It was less than a year, actually. The one that leaked was less than a year.
So,
Mr. Lutz, you cited the article by the Edison engineers. Do you have the site for that so I can look it up? I'd like to see that.
You can go directly to the Nuclear Engineering International. Google that. And actually, if you email me or go to the Citizens Oversight, I'll make sure that I have it at the top, .org. That is written by the engineers that designed these things, and it's the evidence that you'll see is just catastrophic what they went through to work around the NRC and redesign those things, and they were proud of it at the time because it was written in maybe October.
Right, you made that point. Yeah. So that's, you mentioned you have an engineering background. Well, what's your field?
Electronics engineering.
Okay.
But it's you go through engineering, you hit all of the basic thermodynamics, and I'll tell you something about thermodynamics and fluid dynamics, which is what they're talking about here. These steam generators have fluids running through them, high pressures and temperatures. Fluid dynamics is almost impossible to model. They say even the common toilet is impossible to mathematically model. You cannot get that through a simulator. So they need to model these things and make sure that they're working. Their models are broken. It's just very, very hard to do. It's one of the hardest problems there is.
Mr. Lutz, just this, as an engineer.
Okay.
Okay, you get some face time this afternoon with the NRC chair. What's the key question to ask him? What do you want him to answer to you?
Well, I think that, number one, they have to go back and find out what is wrong with the steam generators. Why is it that you can have your top engineers go so wrong?
Root cause.
What is the cause of this? How did it happen? And if they're going to restart this or even think about it, they better thoroughly understand the problem. Because this is not a test bed. This is not a place where you run tests. And their point of view is, and he says in his article, we're not sure if these will function correctly. Well, folks, I'm not willing to put new stuff into this thing. They're not even sure it'll work. They think this is a test bed. We'll experiment out here with some new designs. This whole industry is a big experiment because you know what? They haven't had much history with these huge, very dangerous reactors. It is an area of technology that I researched Three Mile Island intently, and I came to the conclusion that human beings cannot run this type of a plant. We're just too error prone. We make mistakes and we think we get it all right. Even though we think we're right all the time, guess what? We're wrong most of the time. And so that's the problem that comes in. And I don't trust human beings to run this type of dangerous plant. This is what it comes down to. And so we're gonna all be asking them questions. Everybody involved here are maybe having their own questions, but you know that all centers on
these steam generators that they had full control of, and they just redesigned them to be perfect, and they failed immediately. Something's wrong, very wrong here, and that's what we're going to be mainly talking about. My position is these are not going to be starting either for a very long time, if not forever, because they don't have a clue about what's going on so far. And it's going to take probably making a whole new steam generator full size and running an experimental plant with non-nuclear material to find out what's going on. And they're never going to do this. This is beyond the comprehension of what we understand about technology right now. And I don't trust the, even though I'm an engineer and pro technology, I don't trust this with human beings. It's just too dangerous.
Ray, when you say they, you mean Edison and the NRC?
I'm saying human beings cannot be trusted with this type of dangerous material. Human beings, I don't care which department you talk about. It could be in Japan, it could be in Russia, it could be the NRC, it could be Southern California Edison with money flowing out of their brains. They cannot get it, it is not gonna be safe. And so therefore, what do? We have plenty of sun here. I understand three states turned over to wind power, wood power, give enough power to everyone in the United States five times over, and that's if everyone has an electric car. We do not have a deficit of energy if we just generate it correctly. Why do they have this here? Because they can make a lot of money if they sell the power. And if we put in solar panels, guess what? They're not making any money because we're generating our own. All the green talk you hear from these power companies, that's what's behind it. They've got a lot of money on the table that they're going to lose if they can't run these dangerous plants. Profit, that's what it comes down to. And we have to stand for the public and against these profit motives when they get in the way of doing the right thing.
Could some of the rest of you?
I just wanted to go back to the question that was posed about what do we expect from the Nuclear Regulatory Commission? And that's a very important question. We have demonstrated why we've lost faith in this institution, and we have good reasons for not trusting the NRC. But this is an opportunity for the NRC to win the public's trust back. We want to see what they do. We want very open, transparent dialogue. We want public participation, and we want independent validation of their findings. We don't want to rush into this decision. And we think it's a great opportunity for the NRC to step up, do their job, find where they've been deficient, and be realistic and compassionate and realize that there's so much at stake here. We're not going to let them make any more mistakes.
Thank Gary, you. Do you see any possible scenario where it would be safe for them to restart the plant, or do you also want to see it permanently decommissioned at this point?
Well, you know, based on what I know and what I've seen in Fukushima and my experience with whistleblowers, I'm pretty convinced that this is time to move on to a new technology. My main concern is what we live next to right here, this particular power plant. I'm open-minded. I'm like most people. I think we want to understand the risk and benefits, but from what I've seen, there are so many other green alternatives. We're just going to be left behind by other countries that do take the bold challenges and embrace the changes in the future. Any other questions? Or
if this plant reopens under these present conditions without the proper testing and the proper confirmation by independent sources, and there's an accident, they will kill not only the nuclear industry in the United States, but they will kill the eighth largest economy in the world, California. Nobody wants that to happen at this time in the world economy. So it is ridiculous to think that. The other thing that's a major problem over there, there's about 1,500 tons of high-level nuclear waste over there. And it's higher-level nuclear waste than in Japan because we ran it longer. We run our fuel about 22 months. Japan ran theirs about 15 or 16 months before they recycled it. We take it out at 22 months, meaning that it's higher level high-level plutonium waste. So if that plant goes off where not the reactors, but if there's a problem with the spent fuel rods, then we are in worse trouble than Japan.
Donna
Gilmore. Regarding the comment of what will we do if San Onofre's down, there's another chart. I'm sorry I didn't bring a larger one. There's a little red line. That shows the amount of nuclear power California brings. The green line is our surplus energy in California. So we're risking the country's breadbasket. We're risking the future of this nation for energy we don't need. If that isn't insane, I don't know what is.
Yeah!
Yeah. Woo! My name's Ace Hoffman, A-C-E-H-O-F-F-M-A-N. And the question was asked, why don't we trust the NRC? And one of the reasons is that we've been to the NRC many, many times. For decades, we've gone to the NRC and we've told them about problems that we see at the plant. Little problems, big problems, enormous problems, unsolvable problems. It doesn't make any difference. Nothing ever changes. After Unit 1 went down because it had hundreds and hundreds of worn tubes, we said, why don't you look at Unit 3? But they didn't do anything. They didn't look at Unit 3. And now they're not really looking at the two units together. They want to separate the two and get Unit 2 started and leave Unit 3 until they can put new steam generators in, because you know they only tested one tube in Unit 2. They need to test a lot more tubes in Unit 2. In fact, they need to test so many tubes that there's not going to be enough tubes left to run the thing. And I'm dead serious about that. This is a statistical engineering problem. And they had 8 failures when they went and tested. That's just among the ones that they looked at. There's 10,000 tubes in each of four generators. That's 40,000 tubes. They're not looking at them at all. We're just taking our chances if we start this thing. And thank you very much. We'll take questions.
Thank you.
Were there any other questions we might be able to answer for you?
One-on-one question.
Yeah.
Okay. Gary, one question quickly.
Yes.
What do you expect to get out of this meeting with the NRC chairman later today? It's a private meeting. Media has no access. What do you expect? Do you expect anything really to happen at this meeting other than what you
expect
here today?
I'm pretty hopeful. I think the fact that so many top-level people are attending these meetings indicates the seriousness of it. And we're giving the NRC a chance to redeem themselves in our eyes. So they can take the opportunity or they can walk. But if they walk, we're going to keep them from starting this plant.
Gary, I want to say something.
No.
They can
I'm Nancy Nolan, N-O-L-A-N, Nancy. Recently, France, who is highly dependent on their nuclear power, conducted a study, and it was found that in areas surrounding the nuclear power plants there was a higher incidence of cancers. And we haven't talked about the problems that the health poses if the plant stays open, or even since it's been open for the number of years that it has. And I would like to bring that out as a concern for the plant to never open again, because there's probably, because there hasn't been a study done here yet, hopefully there will be a study done, as France has done, to bring this fact out. Thank you.
If you haven't seen these pictures, this young boy here is from Chernobyl area, and he's extremely deformed from the radiation. I just read today that the different studies showed that it was nearly 1 million people died from premature cancers in Chernobyl. Now you always hear, well, no one's died from cancer or anything in the United States from nuclear. They're the safest thing around. This is all worked figures, because they're not looking at the time delayed effects which occur 10-20 years downstream. These are pictures that you usually don't see, because they almost look like we're pro-lifers here with some pictures of fetuses and stuff. These are real pictures of what happens to people who live in the area. And you cannot, it's scary. And that's what's happening, is the media sometimes is saying, well, it's too scary to tell people. You know, we could have a disaster here, but let's not tell anybody because it's a little bit too scary for everyone. I'm sorry, we got to be scared, because this is reality. And it's much too risky to continue this, because we take all the risk. You know, these companies, they don't take any risk. If this goes down, guess who's going to have to pay for it? We do. They don't have any risk tied up in these. They allow on the public to take that risk. If They had to take the risk of running these plants. Not a one would ever be built. They're way too risky for their spreadsheet when they go to their stockholders. Those stockholders that put money into these power companies, they're not taking any risk at all. When could they lose their money? Never. This plant goes into full meltdown, doesn't matter. The plant makes more money to clean it up. And then we have to pay them a profit on every dollar. So they don't really care. In fact, if it probably melts down, they'll make more money than if it was running. That's the disaster of this profit incentive we have set up. And time and again, these power companies go in the wrong direction toward more money versus the right direction, the way the community wants them to go and the way that we should be going, because it's against their profit motive.
Okay. I wanted to answer your question about what do we expect to get out of today's meeting. What I have learned is that the decision makers at the top are not always given the facts. We haven't had a voice to talk to the people that can really protect our lives. I have showed this to elected officials, and they were totally shocked. These are the people that are making decisions for our future, and they have no idea this is going on. So they're only hearing one side of the story. So I'm hopeful that the chairman, when he really learns the true facts from somebody that doesn't make their living from this industry, that they will make better decisions.
All right, are there any other questions, or should we call it a wrap? Okay, we'll be around for anyone that wants to talk. Thanks.